Those are the changes. Now let's go to the outline and see what's going on as far as the flow is concerned. All right, so non-NAFTA, as mentioned before, drawback defined as the duty fee or tax which was imposed on imported merchandise. So merchandise has to be some kind of import, right? There is a lesser test of stuff. So refund of internal revenue taxes paid on domestic alcohol. If you those excise taxes which must be paid on the production of distilled spirits, if you bring them out, you can get the refund claim. Although this alcohol taxation stuff, they're not, customs examiners are not huge on testing you on this stuff. They're mostly testing you on the first point. All right, so what duties and fees are eligible for refund? As I mentioned, most of them, pretty much all of them, are eligible. There are few minor carve-outs which we shall see, but let's take a look. So all ordinary, and here is the punchline, ordinary duties and fees, which includes estimated duties, final duties, and voluntary tenders, which usually is made after the entry and before the liquidation. Marking duties, so let's say there is a 10% penalty duty for failure to properly mark. Let's say you were supposed to mark the particular scissors by etching country of origin on those scissors, because there is a specific regulation that says those specific items must be marked in specific kind of way. And instead of using this etching method on the scissors, you decide just to slap on the plastic label, which peels off. That's not appropriate marking. Customs saw this and said, okay, you're gonna have to relabel that, but on top of that, you're gonna have to pay a penalty. This is how it works. We talked more about this in the marking chapter. We discussed a case law related to that. So if you are not feeling well with that 10% marking stuff, then you should go back to that country of origin marking chapter and have a review of that. IRS taxes. So those taxes, there is pretty much two major types of taxes. One of them relates to production of alcohol. Another one is environmental taxes that are assessed by the federal government. For example, microwaves that are deemed environmentally harmful. So the tax, provided that there is a criteria for that, and with that, I am asking you to go into the submission of taxes chapter, we discussed more heavily in there. You pay this at the time of entry. So customs collects IRS taxes on behalf of Internal Revenue Service. Liquidated damages is another form of money collection. So let's say you breached your terms under the bond. And the bond condition stipulates that, let's say you didn't pay, the bond condition says that you must redeliver the merchandise within, let's say, 60 days, and you failed to redeliver. So customs says, okay, we're going to, you breached your bond conditions, you failed to redeliver the merchandise. So we are going to assess the liquidated damages, and they send you the bill, right? And then you pay those damages, right? And then you collect, you finally got this merchandise, you export it out of the country, or you find some kind of substitution. Merchandise processing fee subject to exceptions as the, because regulations have not changed, but those exceptions have been removed by the law for the major part. And of course, here is the question, which relates to what is not refundable under drawback, and they go through the laundry list and they say, harbor maintenance fee is not on the list. Harbor maintenance fee is of course required, is a fee assessed under section 24.24 or 24.23. I do not recall. I think 24.24 of the 19 Code of Federal Regulations, and it is a fee to collected by customs to maintain a harbor, and it applies to the entries which arrive into this country by the sea. So if something arrives by the plane, unless it's like a hydroplane, you're not being assessed harbor maintenance fee. All right, tenders of duties in connection with prior disclosure. So that's voluntary tenders right there, right? Okay. Duties and fees not eligible for drawback. All right. So as I mentioned that Trade Facilitation Trade Enforcement Act changed a lot of that, and in that letter that we just saw, we saw that the act now evenly allows refunds of 99% of duties, taxes, and imported merchandise fees for all drawback, right? Let's see, right here. All right, in addition to harbor maintenance fee, merchandise processing fee, there is also other duties which are kind of punishable penalty duties, and those are the type of duties which have not been mentioned by the, at least explicitly by the international trade community, to be exempted from the Trade Enforcement and Trade Facilitation Act. I may be wrong, but at least what it looks like now is if you, and this is serious because I've seen situations where someone, and licensed customs broker, the professional folks, they made this mistake because probably they, as they were studying for the customs license broker, they didn't pay very much attention to the drawback portion of the class. You have the merchandise arriving into the United States, and it's subject to anti-dumping duties. So the licensed customs broker, I'm not going to use the names, but that licensed customs broker imported the merchandise and then quickly exported it to Canada. So, but the fact that there was an entry for consumption made was done, right? The idea is, okay, if I export it to Canada and then I do whatever I want with it in Canada, then we can play around and get the duties back. No, that's not possible. What should have been done is for that anti-dumping merchandise was not to file the consumption entry and quickly export it to Canada, right? Because it's not once you file a consumption entry, how quickly you export it is really not relevant, because the obligation to pay those duties kicks in. But what should have been done is there should have been done some TNE, transportation exportation entry, or immediate transportation entry and then exportation, or just pure out exportation entry, because the merchandise was able to, without using the land transport and therefore need for inbound transportation requirement, just being flown out of the country without even entering the customs territory of the United States. So those those are the pointers, right? So those are still the type of duties that you are not going to get you, will not be able to get your drawback on, but the list has shrinked. So those are the candidates. It used to be that those came with strings attached, and we shall see what those strings are, especially for the merchandise processing fee. But from the past question on the licensed customs broker exam, we see the anti-dumping duties being tested as the ones that are not subject to drawback. Which one of the following duties and fees not subject to drawback? Anti-dumping, right? So those guys, keep in mind, they do come up on the licensed customs broker exam. All right, now drawback for merchandise processing fee. So I know the trade enforcement and trade facilitation act changed all that, right? But it used to be that MPF, merchandise processing fee, could only be claimed on two types of drawback: unused merchandise and substitution of finished petroleum derivatives. So manufacturing was not eligible, and rejected merchandise was not eligible, right? And merchandise processing fee are not subject to drawback except substitution. So those types of drawback which are eligible are not eligible, I'm sorry. And they ask you for the exception, right? Unused, eligible. Substitution used merchandise is really not the type of drawback which can be out there. Substitution of finished petroleum right here. Rejected merchandise is not on the list. And substitution of indirect used merchandise is not on the list, but then again, substitution of indirect used merchandise, there is no such drawback claim. Those are the major ones. Stick to that list. If you see something weird, it's not the right answer. So here customs made up this one, and they made up this one. So if it sounds nonsense, even though it may sound like they're making sense, no. Stick to the list, folks. Just remember those, and remember the statutes, subsections with which they are associated. All right, so drawback types and variations we discussed. We're talking about manufacturing, unused merchandise, rejected merchandise, and substitution of finished petroleum derivatives. So again, customs comes out and says, and gives this type of question on exam, which of the following is not a type of drawback entry, right? So they give you all the ones that are on the list, and then they make one which sounds strange. Substitution modified merchandise. It may be sound like substitution rejected merchandise, right? But modified, unused merchandise. Merchandise sounds like a buzzword, but here there is no such thing. It's either unused or rejected. And one way to really get this down, if you don't like the outline type, if you're not the outline type person, but the regulation type person. Recall the part 191 that relates to drawback, right? So go to the subparts, right? Manufacturing drawback, right? There is substitution and direct identification variations. Unused merchandise drawback, also direct identification and substitution, right? Then there is rejected merchandise drawback over here, right? Then it goes to the procedure, procedure. I'm trying to get to this. Derivatives. Yeah, substitution of finished petroleum derivatives drawback. All right. And there are various others. For since the goal of this class is to focus on what's relevant for the purpose of customs broker examination, we are skipping a lot of the stuff, which are very interesting stuff from the practitioner's perspective. But because, first of all, it's a vast topic in itself. It shows up quite frequently on a customs broker exam, and there is already enough material to digest in addition to all the other stuff. So keep in mind that whatever we discuss is by means not the end of the game. It's merely the beginning, right? So in a way, while I may go deep into this, it's really the bare bones stuff that we're covering as the stuff I've been tested on a licensed customs broker exam. All right, so back to the outline. So substitution modified merchandise drawback is not the type of drawback which is out is out there. All right, so here is the chart again. Check your outline, check your textbook chapter. You should see it there. Remember to associate those particular laws and legal requirements with the ones with a specific types of merchandise products. All right.